Welcome to ZKast, everyone. I'm ZS Caravalla from CK Research, and I'm joined today by Don Marie Elder. You are the Chief Revenue Officer over at SIPPIO. Don, you and I are going to talk about telephony and some of the myths and realities. There's a lot of chatter in the industry that it's dead. Is it not dead? So I think it'll be a good discussion. Before we get into that, though, can you just give a quick introduction to yourself and also who SIPPIO is?
Okay, great. So hi, I'm Don Marie Elder. I've been with SIPPIO since we started. We're coming up on our fifth year birthday on June 18th of 2019 was when we launched. And before that, it was with Microsoft and in the Microsoft ecosystem for quite a long time. And then I also did a little stint at Avaya, which I think most people in telco have. Yeah. At least every time I seem to meet somebody, they say, oh, I was at Avaya. And I thought, oh, if I just got a quarter from every person, I'd have a whole jar of them. But yeah. What's really interesting about the Microsoft and the Avaya, and the reason I bring it up is I never would have guessed when I was at either place that these two worlds would kind of come together like peanut butter and chocolate, that telephony services would now be available in desktop applications. But lo and behold, you know, the world is changing and here we are with it. So you asked me about SIPPIO, and really what SIPPIO does is we provide the ability for our partners and carriers to build a healthy revenue stream around voice, working with Microsoft Teams and Zoom. We started back in 2019 with direct routing, then we added Zoom, then we added Operator Connect, and now we're starting to add on all the options for call recording, SMS, meeting insights, all those things that kind of surround voice and make voice better because they're additive to the experience.
Yeah. And I, you know, your comment around the convergence of the Avaya world and Microsoft world is interesting because I think it's this, and I think sometimes it flies under the radar of business executives, but communications is core to business, right? And when you think of digital transformation, if you can't communicate and collaborate effectively with your customers, with your employees, then those initiatives largely are going to fail. So I think that's been kind of an interesting transition that a lot of the application vendors have seen, but it's very quietly made its way into the world of telephony. And so I'm glad we're having this conversation. And Don Marie, when you think of the world of telephony, with the rise of digital channels, there's a perception out there that telephony is dead and all calling will eventually go away. In fact, I think one of my peer analyst firms actually wrote something a few years ago talking about, you know, the death of calling. What's your reaction to that? Is telephony becoming more or less important? And, you know, obviously AI is coming. Does that have any impact on it as well?
Sure. I think if it's status quo the way that it is today, I would actually agree with a lot of that sentiment because the number of phone calls has been on the decline, or the minutes used has been on the decline, because people can IM or they can, you know, email. But not to tip our hand with where the conversation is going, I think AI has the ability to allow the phone call to really reinvent itself and become more relevant than ever before and change how its perception and its usage is to the next generation of workforces that are coming in, you know, behind us.
Yeah, and I think there's some obviously overlap between what a call is and what a meeting is. Mm-hmm. You know, that, you know, there's many times in a day where I'll have a conversation like this, and is it a call? Is it a meeting? And so I think a lot of meeting minutes have chewed up calling minutes, but to me, they're two sides of the same coin. So when you think of this, you mentioned status quo, well, what's driving the continued use of telephony? Are you seeing specific types of companies, industries, you know, that are, you know, where it does live on and it does become more important?
Sure, because the modality of meetings that you just mentioned aren't always appropriate. IMing isn't always appropriate. Email isn't always appropriate. Like if I want to get into my doctor's office, I don't schedule a video meeting to set up an appointment to go to that physical meeting to meet with my doctor, right? That's just a simple explanation. But situations like contract negotiations, scheduling appointments, you know, clarifying projects, deliverables, asking about an invoice or a bill, those are all reasons why people pick up a phone and they just want to connect with somebody else. Because oftentimes, by the time you type all that out, it's just easier to have a phone conversation about it. And then that phone conversation, you can be really clear. You can do direct follow-up right there. People understand your intention, your tone and tenor. And email has had some challenges with that, you know, over the years. I know my email usage continues to decline because it's just easier to talk with somebody than to do all that typing. And I'm trying to preserve, you know, my hands for later in life because it'll be interesting to see what happens to people that grew up with the thumb thing.
Yeah, big thumbs. I think also one thing that gets misunderstood too is the criticalness of calling for certain types of use cases where I was talking with the CIO of one of the mobile payment companies, and they initially didn't have any voice in their contact center because they were targeting younger people and they thought they'd message for everything. But what he didn't really give credence to is when people want to talk about money, you know, and you mentioned the doctor's appointment, when we talk about your health, you want to talk to somebody. You don't want to send a message and hope you get a response, right? And so I think when there's things that cause us a lot of anxiety or we want a quick response, it is when we still call. So when you think about phone-centric processes or use cases, what are customers telling you? Where are they at with that right now? What are they thinking about?
Yeah, so you're probably hearing this as well, but like call center has just blown up the last couple of years in terms of its importance. And call centers have been around for a while. The old use case for call center is I didn't want to have to physically go to my bank. So I would call to talk to somebody about my money or whatever the situation is. Same with credit cards and, you know, other things like your electric bill or your gas bill, right? If you didn't want to physically go there, you didn't want to write a letter, then the next way to deal with something was to call them. But the new way of calling or call centers are working is not to get that first call because so much of this data and information is self-service on your application. You know, everything is your whole life is on this. And this is why these things are tethered to people and never more than probably a few inches from where you're sitting or standing on any given day. But now when I need to call somebody, it's because I can't self-service that information or I'm stuck. And then I just want to call somebody and talk to somebody. And I'm really impatient personally when I do it. I don't want to go through the auto prompts when I'm calling. I just want to get to a person. So I'll just sit there and hit that zero button until I get to that person. So I think call centers have really, really changed. And there's so many use cases that surround that. And like your example of the individual that you talked with, the millennials probably and the Gen Zers probably tried to get that information first. But then when they weren't successful, then, okay, what do they do next if they've got a call?
Yeah. And, I agree with your thesis on the importance of telephony and calling. And it's been interesting too, that if you were at the recent Enterprise Connect show or just like at any of the messaging from the UCaaS vendors, you look at Zoom, how much money they put into Zoom Phone and Microsoft Teams with calling, they've been pushing that for years. And so it does appear that even within an industry that tried to disrupt calling, they are now putting more money and more R&D into calling to try and drive innovation into it. And so can you talk about what kind of new features or innovations you expect to see over the next few years in this area?
So, Zace, I think it's a good question because the innovation, I think, really comes from moving away from having a standalone phone system that its primary function is phone into making phone a feature of Microsoft Teams and Zoom. So it's in that same modality where you're doing all your desktop productivity work anyhow. So as you're emailing, you can see phone calls pop up. As you're IMing, you can switch that IM to a phone call. As you're, you know, looking or discussing something in a shared document, you can move that to a phone call. So I think that that's different than the standalone PBXs of yesteryear, where they've gravitated the other way. They had a phone system and then they're trying to add the pieces on top of it. Microsoft and Zoom had the desktop and they're adding the phone to it. And you might think back to, I think it was 2008 when somebody did something really innovative that was similar to that. And Steve Jobs stood on stage and said, oh, we're going to have our camera camera, we're going to have a music device, and we're going to have a phone. And everybody was expecting, you know, three different devices, but it was one, and it was bringing all those things collectively together. And I think that that's the way Microsoft and Zoom are going. And I also think now, you know, the AI is going to change everything. Now that they have the availability of a phone as a feature.
Yeah, so let's talk about that intersection of communications and AI. It's been a big part of every communication show, Enterprise Connect, the last few years, Context Center World. If there's communications, there's AI. So talk about the coming together of those two. Historically, when you think of voice, there's always been voice data, but that data's been dark, right? And not really usable by anybody to do any kind of analytics with. But that's no longer the case, correct?
That's right. That's right. So I said this to my team recently, so I'll do it for fun and see if it resonates with you. But you remember when MTV came out, the very first song that they played was Video Killed the Radio Star.
Yeah.
Not necessarily the truth, but you got the point of that, right? And I kind of updated these words recently in our team call and said, AI will change the phone call. You know, kind of humming along to that old tune. So with AI, you've alluded to this already, data was kind of dark and phone calls used to be sort of static, one-to-one, it had no life to it. And if you were having a conversation with somebody, it was up to you to document that conversation or write your notes down or create a follow-up and remember what was said. And that call was pretty static and just had, you know, it's if you're listening in or the AI is listening in to those phone calls, you can create something that's a lot more dynamic because you can have all the data available. Today, most of that data is just like call center type of people. But if you're looking at either recording that data or summarizing it and storing it somewhere, simple use cases can come out of that. One is just an individual call, right? That is providing a summary. It's doing the follow-up. It's creating task lists and owners, and it's tracking down those people. A more advanced use case of that would then be aggregating calls across an entire business or a division or some type of department. If you're aggregating that data, you know, there's a greater amount of data that can be collected and analyzed. And think of the training and reinforcement that could be had as you're learning. Are my sales teams really saying the right value prop collectively? Or who knows what's going on these calls? And how you know, a marketing person or a senior executive might be able to gain insights that they don't have the ability to tap into today, and how that may fundamentally change how businesses look at themselves. And then if you bring in data from other systems, such as your email and your instant messaging, really getting a holistic picture, both on an individual and a company, to what's being said and how it's being said.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of really exciting possibilities there. When you think about a sales manager having to go through the process of training some new, you know, some junior salespeople, typically the model would be you just listen in on random phone calls and you hope something goes awry. You hope there's a coachable moment. With AI, it can listen to all your calls simultaneously and then only flag the ones that actually need, you know, that actually need support. And so I think from, especially in this world of remote work today, you think of the old, you know, inside sales bullpen where a sales manager could audibly listen for things going on,
right,
and you could pick
right.
cues. You don't have to worry about that anymore because now AI can listen to all of them. And your point on the coming together with the digital channels is interesting too, because we don't really have a good view of customer experience or employee experience, right? We just have these silos of different data sets. And if you apply AI to a silo, you get to a silo, you get fragmented insights. And so talk about the overlap there with telephony and the other digital channels like SMS and the like, and what you see as the future there.
Yeah, so I think that there's a lot of opportunity for, you know, horizontal applications, like the sales team that we just talked about. It's a horizontal application utilizing AI for recruiting. We just did this, actually. So we had the AI, the co-pilot, listen in on Teams calls to interviews that we were doing. And then we fed the transcript of that interview along with the job description and the person's resume and asked the AI to give us some insights into how it felt that the candidate was qualified for the position. And it was really interesting because the AI hears different things than a human does, because humans, whether you like it or not, tend to come to situations with bias and experience, and not intentional, but just that's the way that we are. So it gave some really nice summaries of the candidate and actually pointed out the gaps that maybe we would have overlooked. And then it also gave us a list of questions for the next person in the interview round to drill into, to see if we could fill those holes and those gaps. So that's like another vertical application. But then I think the whole world might change once we get these new rules in place. I think they're calling them prompt specialists or prompt scientists, but basically people that learn how to write the prompts that ask the AI the question to get the right answer. And so much of what comes out of Copilot and some of the other tools that are out there like ChatGPT is based on what you ask it. So you have to, like in Jeopardy, you have to ask the right question to get the answer that you're looking for. But think about when this is applied to a vertical, you know, whether that's a legal profession, healthcare profession, manufacturing, and it's able to aggregate those calls throughout a business, and it may come up with things that you never dreamed of were an issue. You know, your sales teams are selling something, but your production line can't fulfill whatever that product or that good is for 3 months because there's this one little bitty process in the middle that is broken. It would probably take a series of people and a committee and a task force to sit there and figure that out over time. Oftentimes people just learn to live with things like that. I know we do sometimes, but if it's looking for, and it's trolling that data and making those points come out and somebody can react and change a process for the better, there's so many cost efficiencies and then also revenue opportunities that can be born out of what's happening in a business today, but just is going unheard.
Yeah, no, I agree with you there. I think that, again, this all comes down to, do you have the data to run the analytics? And so you can have the best AI tools, but if you don't have the data to be able to power those, then you're not really going to get the insights you need. So let's pivot now to talk about SIPPIO specifically. And talk about the relationship you have with companies like Microsoft and Zoom to help them deliver better quality calling to their customers and how you work with them.
Yeah, so we're certified by both Microsoft and Zoom as one of the Operator Connect providers. And in the Zoom world, it's called Provider Exchange. And what that means through the certification is both of them had these like 75-page documents with little checkboxes of meeting security and different certifications and, you know, all the acronyms that are out there for compliance, as well as SLAs, so that they were comfortable in knowing and understanding that our solution can deliver. We run hundreds of thousands of users every month, millions and millions and millions of minutes. I get about 12 support calls a week. Our support team has full-time jobs. We call them the Maytag men, just as a joke, because they're waiting for that phone to ring, which is why they have other jobs, because of how our architecture was put together in the Microsoft Azure cloud and platform. We just have stability, and we don't have to worry about that. And we rest at night. We're not waking up people, even with all of our international footprint and users that we have globally. We're not waking up people in the middle of the night to answer. So I think that that's one of the things that's first and foremost about our solution. But really, really what differentiates SIPPIO from other things that are available or other calling plans or other solutions that are available in the marketplace is just the application. You know, we started in 2019, we were one of the first to market with an as a service model. And in order to service that as a service model, because we go to market only through a channel ecosystem, we started to develop a tool, a GUI interface to surround that, so that that experience could be as easy as, you know, using Netflix and getting signed up for that by any end customer or a partner on their behalf. And we've designed everything around people and the roles that they have. So there's KPIs in there for executives, there's ease of ordering for a salesperson or an order entry clerk. There's the ability to rationalize an invoice for an accounts payable person before they, you know, pay a bill. And then there's the ability for a help desk or an IT person to manage and make changes to numbers, emergency services addresses, all in seconds and just with ease, because we thought about the functions a person would do and how to make that function easy for them. And a lot of times our tool set isn't necessarily just rolled out to an IT help desk. It can be rolled out to, you know, somebody that's an office manager and is managing, you know, their voice environment for everybody, you know, in that office. So that's the way that we've differentiated it, is just a rock solid platform and architecture that's global in reach, that has failover, that doesn't have service issues or outages, and then the innovation around the tools and the platform.
Yeah, you know, I'm glad you brought that up, because it's one of the, I guess, the kind of boring things of a calling that goes underappreciated until it's a problem, is just the reliability of the platform. And when I talk to customers about why you chose this provider, why you chose this provider, the number one thing I always say is reliability. And so you can have all the bells and whistles you want, but if you can't keep your platform up, then obviously those bells and whistles don't really matter. And I think sometimes when these newer vendors try and get into the world of calling, they don't fully appreciate how hard it is to run that kind of highly reliable infrastructure. Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah, I absolutely agree. And one of the things that we've been able to do with Microsoft's Accelerate program is offer our platform and our tool set to people that are looking at entering into the marketplace. So we have a lot of carriers. They're big carriers, and you would never know that that SIPPIO is underneath all of the covers somewhere deep, you know, in there. And a lot of the innovation in our tool set, especially our CPQ, which is the quote to cash feature, you know, was designed to the specs of what certain carriers wanted in order to get into Operator Connect, so that they could support their launch and make sure that they had a, you know, a viable experience for their customers. Because a lot of carriers traditionally aren't end user focused, and they're not necessarily equipped to build out a GUI or an application, because, you know, they do other things really, really, really well.
Yeah. So you're the platform underneath the platform. So one last question for you, Don Marie, and that's looking your crystal ball here and talk about the future of communications and the role calling is going to play or not play.
Yeah. I think if we all start focusing on how that phone call, you know, could be advanced and could become an asset to an organization, and set our sights on how do we modernize that and give people reasons to make phone calls, because we know that we can either monetize the data, learn something from the data, or get some sort of cost savings or efficiencies from the data, then we can shift to more of a business outcome approach. And with those prompt developers that I mentioned, you know, earlier, I haven't even begun to like scratch the surface of what I think vertical applications, you know, could be and should be. But I really think that combining that phone data with everything else, you know, in an organization will breed innovation that we haven't even thought of. If you think back to the beginning of instant messaging, did you ever think there would be something like Snapchat, where you would have an avatar and pictures and the pictures dissolve, but then a year later it says, oh, last year you did this. I mean, that's just one simple idea of how they took something basic, like an instant message, and made it into a value, you know, added service that every Gen Zer in America is probably utilizing. Because if I want to communicate with my 19-year-old daughter, I've got to go to Snapchat because she never checks regular iMessage on Apple.
Yeah, it's interesting that what started actually is BlackBerry Messenger, I guess, way back in the day, has evolved into one of the biggest retail channels out there, right? The retailers use IG messaging and Snapchat and things like that to actually sell products. And so it's not just for you and I to keep up to date anymore. It's actually become a true revenue generating channel. And that's actually something I've heard from some companies, even with their contact centers. They're trying to rethink how those areas work to become more revenue generating versus just inbound reactive.
Yeah,
and so I think you're right. I think if you can take your perception of what calling is off and rethink that process, there's really untold opportunities here. So
yeah, I agree. I was at an event a year and a half ago, December, in London, and I was on a panel, and it was myself and some of my competitors, and they were all talking about, oh, well, here's what's under the hood of my car. Here's what's under the hood of my car. And then finally, I got an opportunity to talk, and I said, you know, what's under the hood is basically the same for all of us to some degree, because we had to follow the Microsoft and the Zoom specs. Maybe, you know, I've got a 4-cylinder and you've got a 6-cylinder, but at the end of the day, what's under the hood is still the same. But if we don't collectively figure out reasons for the next generation to be making phone calls, it won't matter what's under anybody's hood, because people will just find alternative ways to communicate, like they did with Snapchat and some of the other things. So I'm really passionate about that, about the business outcome piece as opposed to the technical piece. Because even though calling can be complex, you know, under the platform, you know, covers, your average user shouldn't have to worry about that or think about that. It should just work when they want it to work.
Yeah. Well, on that note, I think it's a great place to wrap up. Dunray Elder, is there anything else you want to add?
No, just thanks for having me here today. It's been a pleasure getting to know you. And you owe me a quarter, because I think you played in the Avaya arena, at least as an analyst as well. I'm gonna start collecting that jar. It's not too late.
Yeah, no, I think it's funny, as you're right. People worked at Avaya or Nortel. I think 90% of this industry is all people that are running through there, and it makes sense too. I mean, that those two companies owned the space for a long time, and so if you work in this industry, you would have almost had to have run through there to have any credibility. So.
That's right.
So anyways, I'm happy to Dunray Elder from SIPPIO. I'm ZS Caraval from ZK Research. And thanks for watching. Please hit the subscribe button, and I'll see you next time on the next episode of ZKast. Thanks, Don.